It's always a pleasure to be at New Hope, and Donna and I consider New Hope home away from home. You have been so good to us. You have been so kind to us, so welcoming, so supportive of us. And many persons from New Hope have been to Jamaica and has been a blessing to our church. And those of you who have not yet been there, there is an open invitation for you to come and be a part of what's happening there. There are lots of lost souls in Jamaica. There are lots of people to be ministered to in Jamaica. There are people there who need the Lord. Now, that is a commercial, and if that doesn't get you to come to Jamaica when the group comes in 2018, then there is something that I believe will help to get you there. Always remember that here in Iowa, in February, March, when the group comes, and here in Marshalltown, when it is minus 500 degrees, with 50 feet of snow, it's a nice 85 degrees in Jamaica with a warm, gentle breeze. I don't know how you could resist that, but you're always welcome. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Philippians, chapter 3, verse 12. It says, "Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me." A few weeks ago, Friday evening, I was at home, and Donna and I decided that we were going to go run down to the little restaurant and get some food. So I got in the car, I drove down there, and when I got there, it was a fast food restaurant, but I don't know if it was the food that was fast, but it surely was not the service. And so the line was rather long. There was a young lady in the line, and she was on her break from work, and had just slipped in the restaurant to get some food. It seemed as if our boss only gave her 5 seconds for her break time. And so she had to get in and out, eat her food, and be back at work in 5 seconds. That day, it wasn't Speedy Gonzales who was working. It was the snail's parade that was working. So the line was going rather slowly, and she decided to express herself in terms that were less than honorable. And so after she took out her frustration on the ladies that were working behind the counter, I stood there and I listened to it for a while, and everybody listened to it for a while. And being the shy, introverted person that I am, as most of you know me that I am, I walked up to her and I said to her, "Honey, the rest of us and the rest of the world is extremely slow and inefficient. So since you work for a company that is ultra efficient and the rest of us are not there yet, why don't you take the time to educate us into how to be efficient workers? And as a matter of fact, I'm going to be nice. You don't have to give me an answer now. You can take your time, think about it, and get back to me. I'm still waiting." She has not gotten back to me yet. And the more I thought about it, is this thought came to mind. All of us want other people to be better. But most of us are not thinking about ourselves. And so this message came to me in that restaurant, how to be a better person. And I believe that all of us, if we truly take a look at ourselves, we can all become better people. We should all be becoming better people. Isn't it interesting how we want people to be better drivers on the road? Now, I have come to the conclusion that there is only one single sensible driver on the road, and that is me. All other drivers are idiots. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to insult you, but I've got to state fact. How else would you be driving down the road? I am driving behind you. You are going to turn, and you do not turn on your turn signal to tell me that you're going to turn. The only explanation is that you are. But I don't need to turn on my turn signal, because you see, I know where I am going to turn. And since I know where I'm going to be turning, I would be an idiot to be telling myself that I'm going to be turning here, so I don't need to turn on my turn signal. We all want everybody else to be better. We want people to be better workers to wait on us. We want better neighbors to live beside us. So our neighbors need to get out, and they need to get the manicure set, and they need to manicure the lawn. But my lawn, it's okay if it's overgrown, you know. I don't want the goats to starve, so I'm providing food for them. There's always an explanation. I want better parents' children, don't we all? We want better parents who will understand us. And parents, we want better children who will obey us and listen to us. I don't know about you, but I want some better friends who will always answer my phone call the first time the phone rings. You don't need to wait until it rings 5 or 6 times. The first time it rings, just answer it and just deal with me. I need better spouse. Hello, Miss Donna. Better spouse who will always meet my need. And better yet, anticipate them and meet them before they even come along. Fact of the matter is, everybody should be better. So we behave. Except us. Am I seeking, and each of us need to ask ourselves this morning, am I seeking to be a better person than I was yesterday? Am I seeking to be a better representative of the kingdom of God than I was yesterday? And some of us might be sitting there thinking, man, I wish Joe was here. I wish Mary was here to get this message, because this message is for them. Well, sorry. Since they're not here, I'm going to give it to you. Because the fact of the matter is, none of us are there yet. You see, our standard is not Carriel Graham or Pastor Carey or Billy Graham or some other person. Our standard, the only standard by which we can measure ourselves, is Jesus Christ. And until we are like him, no matter how far we have come, and yes, congratulations on your progress, but it doesn't matter how far we have come in this Christian walk, until we are like Jesus, there's room for improvement. You know, it's like going on a journey, and you pack up the car, load up all the things in the car, and you get the children strapped into the back seat. You start the car, you put in reverse, and as soon as you back up and the two back wheels touch the main road, the children are asking, are we there yet? And many of us are asking ourselves the question, spiritually, am I there yet? Well, sorry, none of us are there yet. Because you see, being a better person is not about being better than somebody else. It is about becoming like Jesus. The Bible tells a story about two men who went up into the temple to pray. Read about it in Luke chapter 18, verses 9 through 14. And the first man, he began to pray. The Bible called him a Pharisee. And he began to pray something like this: Lord, I thank you that I'm not like that jerk standing over there. And he started to compare himself with this man. And of course, he picked out all of these bad qualities that he saw in this person and start to put them up against what he thought was his good quality. And the Bible said this poor publican would not even as much as look up to heaven, but he said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus concluded by saying, this publican, this sinner, this outcast went to his house more justified, in other words, in a better relationship with God than this self-righteous Pharisee. And you know, sometimes if we're not careful, we do that. You see, what I'm talking about, it's not about being better than somebody else. It's about reflecting the glory of Jesus. It's about being transformed into the likeness of Christ. You see, it is God's desire that every single person in here be better persons. And I believe that all of us can take a good look at ourselves. And instead of trying to make Donna better, instead of trying to make your spouse and your neighbor and your co-workers better, may I borrow a phrase or a line, couple of lines, from Michael Jackson's song, The Man in the Mirror. It says, I'm starting with the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to change his ways. And no message could have been any clearer. If I want to make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and then make the change. Because you see, I can't change anybody else. You can't change anybody else. The only person that I can change, the only person that you can change is yourself. And so this morning, as we explore the theme, becoming better people, I want to share with us a few things that will cause us not to become better people. And so as not to finish on a negative note, I also want to share with us a few things that will cause us to become better people. So here goes the negative. These are some of the things that if we do these things and keep on doing these things, we're not going to become better people. So let me list some of them for you. One, no one will ever become a better person if they are contented with themselves the way they are and see no need to change. Let me say that again. If I am quite contented, I am quite happy, I am quite pleased, I am quite impressed with myself the way I am and see no need to change, I'd never become a better person. There is always room for improvement. I pick, as an example, Usain Bolt, the fastest man on earth. If you see that young man train, and every day he gets up, he trains a little harder, a little harder. Because as far as he's concerned, there's always somebody else who is seeking to beat him. And if he gets up and starts patting himself on the shoulder to say, yes, I went to the Rio Olympics, and I won the 100 meters and the 200 meters, and I anchor the gold medal relay, and I am fine and become contented with himself, and just start to rest on his laurel, and just be happy with himself, sooner or later, some young upstart is going to beat him. You know, it's the same thing in business. If you're a salesman, a saleswoman, and in 2015, you were salesperson of the year, and you become so impressed with yourself, and I become so contented with myself, that I have arrived, I am it, then you may make it, I may make it for 2016, but believe me, 2017, somebody else is going to get that award. Once a person becomes contented with themselves to the point that they have arrived and there's no need for further improvement, you never become a better person. Secondly, I never become a better person if I keep comparing myself with others who I think is not as good as me. Our standard must not be other person. Our standard must be Jesus. I'm going to say that again. My standard cannot be my wife. My standard cannot be my pastor. My standard have to be Jesus. Only when I get to his standard, which I'm not going to in this life, can I become satisfied. Thirdly, you never become a better person if you keep minimizing, denying, or justifying your poor performance. You know, many of us can always find an excuse for the way we do things. There's a million and one excuse for justifying doing things the way we do it. There's a situation where a couple of times I would show up at meetings late. And there's always a justification for getting there late. Because you see, when I leave home, the meeting starts at 10. It's going to take me 15 minutes to get there. So what time do I need to leave home? I need to leave home at 14 minutes still. And if I go down and I just happen to drive behind a truck for 5 seconds, guess why I'm late? It's the traffic. And everybody understands that traffic is everywhere, so. And so I'd walk in and I'd say, sorry, I'm late, the traffic. And then I got to the point that I start saying to myself, I can't justify being late. And so Miss Donna, she always have these nice little things that she put on my desk. And she put a plaque on my desk that says, early is on time. On time is late. Late is never acceptable. You try on that one for size. Early is on time. On time is late. Late is never acceptable. We can always find some justification for not doing what we should do. And if we keep justifying, minimizing, or denying, we never, ever improve. A fourth reason I believe, or fourth thing I believe that will cause people from becoming better people is keep taking offense to correction. You know, most of us don't like to be corrected. I have the perfect solution for that. If you don't want to be corrected, the only solution for that is be perfect. But as long as we are not perfect, then we're always going to be corrected. Now, we live in an age where children, young people, most of us don't want to be corrected by our parents. Huh? They're just nagging at us. And the age in which we are living, it seems as if many of us as parents do not know the definition of parent. You know that the word parent can be defined. Parent is both a verb and a noun. It's who you are and what you do. Now we have some newfangled words with newfangled definitions, and some of the old-time words no longer mean what they used to mean. Honestly, how many of you know the definition of parent? Let me see your hands. If you know for sure that you know the definition of parent. Anybody? How many of you would like to know the definition of parent? Here goes. Write this down. Don't forget this. Parent is a compound word. It's made up of two smaller words, pay and rent. So anybody who pays the rent, they're the one in charge. Simple. So there's no fuss, there's no... So I tell my children, as long as I pay the rent, guess what? I'm going to pay rent. The fact of the matter is, in life, we all messed up. And we all need to be corrected. And if we keep taking offense to correction, we'll never become better people. So let me share with us now a few things that I believe that all of us can apply to our lives. And if we apply these things to our life, we'll become better husbands, better fathers, better children, better neighbors, better co-workers, better citizens. Here are a few things. Number one, watch. What do you mean, watch? Watch what you think about. The Bible says, as a person think, so they become. I will never become a better person if I keep thinking negatively. I think it was George Burns who says, every morning when he wakes up, the first thing that he'd do is to read the obituary. And if he did not see his name in the obituary, it was going to be a good day. It's all about how you look at life. Life is not fair, but God is good. I'm going to say that again. Life may not be fair, but God is good. A little boy was coming home from church with his grandmother, and it was Sunday afternoon, typical Jamaican weather, nice cool day of 95 degrees with an 85% humidity. His shoes was a little bit too tight for his feet, and so his shoes was squeezing his feet. And the little boy was walking, and he was limping, and he was complaining all the way home. And his grandmother grabbed a hold of him and gave him a good shake. And he says, you are complaining about your shoes hurting your feet. Are you forgetting about the man that you just passed on the road that has no feet? We can be negative about life. And as long as we go through life being negative, thinking negatively, we never become better people. So Paul says in Philippians 4 verse 8, think on these things. What things? The things that are true, the things that are noble, the things that are just, the things that are pure, the things that are lovely, the things that are of good report. Watch what you think about, because as you think, so you become. Your life tend, my life tend to go in the direction that I think. And your life will never get any higher than your thoughts. So watch what you think about. Secondly, watch what you talk about. Proverbs chapter 18, 21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. And if we keep speaking negatively over our lives, keep speaking negatively over each other, that's what's going to happen. If Pastor Kerry comes here every Sunday and tells you, oh, this church is terrible and it's not going to amount to anything, then pretty soon, after a while, he's going to be preaching to empty benches. Because when we speak death to something, it's going to die. When we speak death to ourselves, it's going to die. When we speak death to our situation, it's going to die. So watch what we talk about, what we think about, but also to watch who we keep company with. Old time proverb says, show me your company and I'll tell you who you are. Paul puts it another way in 1 Corinthians 15:33. Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habit. So we've got to be careful. If we are going to become better people, there are some things that we have got to watch. Watch what we think about, watch what we talk about, and watch who we keep company with. But also, too, if we are going to become better people, what better person to follow than Jesus? You know, Jesus had more things going against him than most of us ever will. I'm going to say that again. Jesus had more things going against him than most of us ever will. Jesus has been called some names that none of us, most of us, never will be called these names. Jesus has been thrown out of some places that most of us never will be thrown out of places like this. But you know what? Jesus didn't let that define who he is or who he becomes. If we are going to become better people, what we have to do, we have to follow Jesus' example. When we read the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, no matter how many times Jesus was knocked down, criticized, poked against, ridiculed, then Jesus did not let that affect who he became. He knew who he was. So you've got to follow the example of Jesus. If we are going to become better people, very importantly, we've got to live by God's word. Brothers and sisters, we are in an age that is becoming increasingly hostile to the word of God. Is it interesting that you can walk into a restaurant and they can play just about any kind of music that they want to play in that restaurant? And you and I as believers have to sit and eat our meal and listen to it. But if they start to play Christian music, then you've got to turn it off. And so the world in which we live, if we are not careful, we conform so much to the patterns of this world rather than living by God's word. We have to get God's word into us. We have to believe it, and we have to live it so that it can transform our lives. And when it transforms our life, it will transform the surrounding around us. So David says, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. We have to get God's word in us so that it can guide us. How do I become a better person? I become a better person by being persistent. I become a better person by being persistent. One of the problems with too many of us too many times is that we are quitters. As soon as we come up against an obstacle, it's time to quit. It's time to run away. But may I challenge us this morning? May I challenge us this morning? That if we're going to become a better person, every time you get knocked down, you get up and you go again. A few weeks ago, Donna and I had the privilege of handing out some scholarships to some young people in Jamaica. We have a group in Montego Bay of pastors that get together and raise money for young people to send them to college. The first Sunday in June, we have a concert, and this is where the bulk of our money comes from. And in order to perform on this concert, there's one criteria. It is called Pastors in Concert. And the qualification to participate in this concert is that you have to have absolutely no talent. If you have any talent, we can't use you. And so we were able to raise some money, and we interviewed 16 students and narrowed it down to 8. And of that 8, one particular young man stood out. Listen what I'm saying. This young man lives in the fruit and vegetable market. And I'm not talking about like your nice fruit and vegetable market with cover and all of that kind. I'm talking about almost out in the open area with animals and you name it. And that was where he lived with his mother and his sister. And he said, Pastor, I have seen everything that you can see on planet Earth. I have seen drugs. I have seen prostitution. I have seen murders. He said, you name it, and I see it on a daily basis. And when this young man, each student were given 15 minutes for the interview, we sat with this young man for an hour and a half just listening to his life story. And I looked down on his application, and I says, I notice on your application what you want to study in college. And this young man who lives in this deplorable condition with everything that is going on around him, look at his application, and he has been accepted straight out of high school, accepted at the University of the West Indies to study medicine. I mean, it broke your heart. But it's also an encouragement to say somebody who has been through all of this can rise to the top. I want to say if we're going to become better people, we have to be persistent. No matter how many times you have been knocked down, get up and try again. And when others have been knocked down, help them up to try again. Finally this morning, how do I become a better person? Become a better person by finding, for lack of a better word, a mentor. What do I mean by that? Find somebody who has been around the block, who has learned some things in life, who can pass on that to you. But also too, in that person, find somebody who loves you but is not overly impressed by you. What do I mean by that? Find somebody who loves you enough to tell you in Christian love when you're being a jerk. Do you have anybody in your life like that? I do. It's not some great man out there. For most of us men, it's our wife. Because sometimes when we're acting like jerks, they don't usually tell us that we're acting like jerks. They just look at us. We need to have somebody who loves us enough to speak the truth to us to say, you're messing up. To speak the truth to us to say, listen, man, you can do better than that. The fact of the matter is, you and I, all of us, would like this world to be better. And I'd love to fix everybody in here. But how about me? I am the only person I can fix. You are the only person you can fix. And you know what? When we become better people, starting with us, this world becomes a better place. Yesterday, Don and I were driving up from Kansas City, coming up here. And we were coming up to the construction zone. And right in front of us was an 18-wheeler. You know when you're coming up to the construction zone and it's going to be single lane, and there's an 18-wheeler, every man in here know what to do. You're supposed to race and get to that lane before that 18-wheeler because he is not supposed to be in front of you for the next 7 miles. And so I took off, and I am going to get there before this man get there because he's supposed to be a better driver. And so I'm racing up there, and within that few seconds, several thoughts passed through my mind. The first one was, the bigger they are, the harder they fall. And I thought, that's not very bright. So I said, let me try 2.0. The bigger they are, the harder they hit. That makes sense. He's bigger, I'm smaller, I'm not going to come out of this smelling like a rose. I'm going to get the worst of this. So I backed off, and he pulled in. And when he pulled in, you know, these drivers thank you for by flashing their light. So he flashes light, and Donna looked over at me and said, look, he's thanking you. And I felt so nice and sweet on the inside, the jerk that I am. I want him to be a better driver. Why didn't it start with me? All of us would like to see this world, this church, this community, our homes, our families, be better. Well, guess what? If that's going to happen, it's not going to start across the table. It's going to start with me. The greatest step in becoming a better person, and I leave this purposely for last because I want to say this. I want you to remember this. The greatest step in becoming a better person begins with a relationship with Jesus Christ. To invite Him into your heart to be your Lord and Savior. If you have never made Jesus your Lord and Savior, today is the perfect day to do that. And when He comes in, He doesn't just fix up the inside and make you into a better person. Because the Bible said in 2 Corinthians 5 verse 17, if any man, if any woman, any boy, any girl is in Christ, they're a new creature. All things are passed away, and behold, all things become new. So if you have never started a relationship with Jesus Christ, in a few moments, the praise team is going to come, and they're going to sing a closing song. And I invite you to just come forward and just publicly confess Jesus Christ as Lord. We'll pray with you, and we'll lead you into those things that you need to do to complete your obedience and your walk with Him. Maybe you're this morning, and having listened to the message, all of us can say within ourselves, there's room for much improvement. I need to leave here being a better father. I need to leave here being a better wife, a better husband, a better mother, a better son, a better daughter. So while it is okay to help fix somebody else, I have to fix me first. I got on the plane coming here, and during the safety instructions, which most of us don't bother to listen to. We're getting ourselves comfortable and getting our reading material and all of this when they're given these safety instructions. There's a little sentence that is usually said in those safety instructions on the plane. And it says, in case of loss of cabin pressure, an oxygen mask will fall from the panel above you. Put on your mask first and then assist those around you. I believe that is applicable here today. Because you see, if this world is going to be a better world, we've got to put on our mask first. We've got to fix ourselves first and then fix others. Each of us must now search our heart. And you must just see those areas in our lives where we need to become better people. And ask the Lord, by the power of the Holy Spirit, to transform us into better people. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for your people who came this morning to listen to your word. By the power of your Holy Spirit, we ask that you will take the spoken word and cause it to become a living word in our hearts and lives. Lord, I pray for that person here who needs to begin a relationship with you, who have never accepted you as Lord and Savior. Lord, even as we sing the closing hymn, may they publicly make that commitment of faith. Lord, each of us now must now examine ourselves to see those areas in our lives that cause for improvement. And rather than trying to fix our families, our friends, and our neighbors, Lord, let that work begin with each of us so that as we go forth from here, we'll go forth to be better persons that will help to transform this world for you and make it into a better world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.